Hi, this is Dr. Carlos Cordon Cardo. I'm the chair of the Department of Pathology for the Icahn School of Medicine. And we are here today just to share with you our thoughts about the developments that we have gone through this pandemic of COVID-19 in order to introduce to you to pathology, to medical sciences that probably it's one of the medical sciences that it's more close to an art, but it's also an art that it's very much guided these days by very solid, robust biological, chemistry, and even mathematical sciences. So who are we, the pathologists? So we are the physicians and the physician scientists behind many other physicians and many other sciences. We are the laboratorians. Part of our mandate is to make sure that we can render a diagnosis, and without a diagnosis, you cannot treat. So we are definitely at the beginning of any kind of patient management. We also monitor the disease, and unfortunately, when some things don't go well, we are also at the end of that process because we are also the professionals that attempt to understand the nature of the disease and the extent of organ damage. So we are also performing scientific and clinically relevant autopsies to address these issues. So in a way, maybe, you know, many individuals don't know who their pathologist is, but relatively, we know better than anybody, all of you. Because since the moment that you are born and we test your blood for your blood type through all of your life, when you are ill, you know, infectious diseases, some symptomatology, when you are into poverty, the new developments in your hormones, when you will need pap smears or a small biopsy, we are constantly going to look at you. The electronic medical record has two kinds of annotations, words, male, diabetic, and numbers, 62, 6 feet tall, glucose, 180, potassium, 3.2. Around 80% of all of the numbers, of all of the metrics in an electronic medical record are coming from pathology. So we really guide with numbers, not with opinion, patient management. So let's use COVID-19 as an example of how pathology has responded and how we became frontliners and how we became critical and put ourselves at the center of patient management during that pandemic. I'm going to share my screen with you so we can navigate together in the context of what we have done. So as we were saying, essential contributions of pathology to any illness are to provide a diagnosis and to be involved in the management of the individual that is suspected or has actually been affected by the disease. That means that we are responsible to provide appropriate testing, not only for diagnosis, but also to attempt to stratify patients. Is this patient somebody very sick, it's intermediate, or it's somebody that it's mildly sick? So from cancer to this kind of pathogen-directed disease, we can stratify patients, and we have stages. Stage one in cancer, it's when the disease is very localized, and it's the same with infectious diseases, as we are going to discuss. And a stage four is when people are metastatic, for example, in cancer and very ill, and they need multiple attempts of treatment if we would like to give that patient the best chance for cure. So it's in that context that we participate and we put ourselves at the center of patient treatment plans as well as monitoring of the disease. So when COVID-19 started in a province in China, in Wuhan, we already had some colleagues in microbiology that were on that very specific site. We had an advantage because we knew from first experience that this was a difficult disease, we started to get sequences of the virus, genetic sequences, the code. So we were able to start producing tools, because when we saw the disease moving from China into part of more West Asia and then later on into Europe, we understood that it was not a matter of if, but a matter of when. This was a new disease for which we were not prepared. We didn't know it. And you don't know what you don't know, but you need to be prepared to try to understand and produce not only data, but also knowledge. One thing is to accumulate data, the other is to translate this data into knowledge. And this is critical in the context of pathology. We generate knowledge, and then we use this knowledge to better manage our patients together with our colleague physicians and also with the patients. Because remember, there is not a better doctor for each of us than ourselves. We know when we don't feel well. We know when something is not right. If we are more or less, you know, willing to accept that and look for professional help, that's another thing. But we know ourselves better than anybody. So we said we need to be prepared. We need to have a plan. And this was our plan. We said qualitative assays, yes or no, will not be sufficient. Maybe everybody is going to do that, but that's not really our mandate. Our mandate is that we are laboratorians, we are scholars, we are in an academic institution. We need to give each patient a better chance of being cured by using all of the tools that we have. And part of the tools that we have is not just qualitative, but also quantitative. Produce a number. Produce a metrics that we can follow, not just opinion. So we decided to produce what we call end-to-end solutions, which means from the diagnosis till the end of the disease, we need to have a plan that is robust. And what we did is we started by trying to identify what was going to be the platform that is going to give us the diagnosis. So we needed to identify the virus. And for that, we decided to go into molecular genetics and to produce PCR, polymerase chain reaction-based tests that were going to give us not only the yes or no in a high throughput, the qualitative, but also what we call the viral load, how much virus particles per ml you have in a sample. And this is produced by quantitative approaches of polymerase chain reactions, which have been published, and they are very robust and scientifically very sound, but clinically also very important. We were also going to do molecular genetics assays by next generation sequencing to find out if the virus was changing, if the virus was mutating, and to see if these mutations could be more harmful for the community and for our own invasion of this specific enemy that we had. And in the same way that now we have the diagnosis strategy in place, because we have tests to identify the virus, how we are going to follow up what's going on. When people say we don't have a treatment for this disease, it's not really the case, because many people have been cured, and some of them without any kind of intervention. Our body gives us the opportunity to produce one of the best treatments against these diseases. It's our own immune system stimulating the B cells to produce antibodies that are specifically killers for that specific pathogen, for that specific virus, and a group of soldiers, the T cells, that they are going to come to help. So we have a humoral response by antibodies, secreted antibodies, and a cellular response by immune cells that they are going to come together to produce a frontal attack. So we needed to know the amount of antibodies and the kind of antibodies. This is called serology. It's called serology because it's in the serum, which is part of our blood. And we decided that we were going to use a test that was going to be simple and capable of being shared by everybody. And we were very lucky to have a terrific colleagues in the Department of Microbiology. Our Department of Microbiology, the academic department, it's one of the top rank in the country. Dr. Palese, the chair, is a member of the National Academy, extremely respected colleague, which main area of expertise is actually virology and influenza, and coronavirus are part of this family. So we had colleagues that were very much prepared to understand what was happening at another level. The clinical laboratory for diagnosis in microbiology is inside of our department, inside of pathology. So we are colleagues that can work together. And in this case, we were able to bring an assay that Florian Kramer developed based on antibodies against the SARS-CoV-2 from the research lab into the clinical lab in a matter of no time. So we were one of the first groups that were able to identify antibodies, monitor the disease, and see who was reacting against the virus, and if the reaction was low, intermediate, or high. Because from very early on, we realized that individuals that succeeded and battled the disease well and produced a blood very rich in antibodies to SARS-CoV-2 could be donors of this plasma to treat patients that were very sick and were not responding very well in order to cure, and it has worked. And now plasma, convalescent plasma therapeutics are being done all over the country. So not only we were able to anticipate and produce tests that are second to none, for which we receive emergency use utilization from both the New York State Department of Health, as well as from federal government, the FDA, but also advance, you know, with our data, the clinical knowledge that a specific therapeutic interventions were going to be very important for some of the patients. And then we decide that part of our mandate is also to understand the disease and the amount of organ damage, the extent of organ damage. So we got together as a department and we uncompromisingly commit ourselves to do as many autopsies as we could in order to bring new knowledge. And actually, we have done, this is an older slide, I thought that I changed the number, but we have done over 110 autopsies in COVID-positive patients, which is the largest series probably in the world. And we have learned quite a bit based on these exercises. Let's look more specifically at what it means, the testing and the monitoring. We needed first to have a test, as we said, that was going to identify the virus. And for that, what we did was to produce viral testing to look at the genetic code of the virus by polymerase chain reaction. In the beginning of the pandemic, this viral test was able to identify many patients that were sick in the context of this pandemic. And some days we were at 60-70% of rate of detection. And this rate of detection became down when the pandemic started to move it away, and the intervention and the distancing that we learned to produce allow us to have these low amounts of detection rate. During the past couple of months, it has been between 1.7 to 0.7 some days. We were very cautious when the time of social unrest happened. We went out there to educate the people by using masks, by distancing, and by keeping hygiene, and this definitely has helped the city of New York. But as critical as was the yes or no, the detection was also to produce a titer, meaning how many particles of viruses are present in 1 ml of the liquid when you have the swab. And that helped us enormously because we learned that patients that were hospitalized, that were relatively sick, if their viral load, if the amount of particles was very high, they did very poorly, and their mortality rate was higher than the ones that had low viral loads. And now these metrics, these assays being used by many other groups, and it's part of a standardized part of the management of these patients. So now that we have the test for diagnosis, which we were one of the first to produce it, and the results were published in high impact journals, we need to move into monitoring, which means that we need to move in antibody testing. For that, we created an ELISA, a test that can be done almost in any small laboratory around the world, because some tests require very high, complex instrumentation, expensive tools. And we had problems in the beginning of the pandemic because we didn't have enough reagents and we didn't have this kind of bandwidth that a simple platform can give us. So we need an immune assay, it's called ELISA, that allows us to produce a high volume of testing. We have done more than 70,000 tests. And by doing that, we have been able to identify more than 25,000 individuals that have sufficient antibodies in their blood. They are very rich in antibodies against COVID-19 in their blood, so we can use them as convalescent plasma donors. which have been critical because we have been treating hundreds of patients that they are very sick and do much better when we give them antibodies that they are high in titers. Why this is important? Because our test was one of the first tests to prove that was not only qualitative, but also quantitative. And if I tell you yes or no, and you are with low levels of antibodies, that will not protect you. You may think that you have soldiers that they are ready to battle, but they are not. They have not even been trained. What is important is to have high levels of soldiers that they are going to be neutralizing, meaning that they are real killers, that they can go into the battle and confront the enemy. And this is what our assay has achieved. And to the best of our knowledge, a couple of weeks ago, we received a special authorization to use this test not only as a qualitative, but as a quantitative, being, to the best of our knowledge, the first test in the country that has obtained this designation by the New York State Department of Health. And that puts together, you know, the context of definition and the context of functionality. We do assays that are mechanistic in the context of function and that can guide not only a better stratification, but also management of the patients. So now that we have the diagnosis, the testing, the monitoring, the antibodies, what else we did? Well, we realized that this was a very unique and difficult disease. And we realized that some patients were coming with symptomatology that we didn't see before in some of these viral coronavirus disorders. People, of course, came with, you know, shortness of breath, with cardiovascular respiratory problems, and we were prepared for that. But some people came with loss of memory, with delirium, with loss of sight, loss of smell, very difficult situations in other areas of the body, with renal failure, with problems in the liver. What was happening? So one of the other contributions of pathologies is to understand the biology, the nature of the disease, and also the range of organ damage. So for that reason, we said we need to do autopsies, and you know, we assure ourselves and our families that we were going to protect ourselves and that we were going to try our best, but that was part of our mandate. That's part of our passion also. Pathology means pathos and logic, the understanding of disease. Pathos is the Greek name for illness. So we are supposed to be the ones guiding the understanding of disease and mechanisms. And this is what we did. And what we learned was represented in the 12 autopsies that I'm going to use for just telling you a little bit what we saw and what we finally were able to produce as a contribution to the understanding of this disease. This is the classical patient that came with a respiratory illness. This is a 57-year-old female that was admitted with fatigue, a little bit of fever, 37.3 is not really high fever. And it's for the reason that in this disease, fever may not be critical, and I'll tell you why in a moment. But definitely with shortness of breath, the saturation of oxygen was already coming down. But look at the markers of inflammation, the C-reactive protein, the ferritin. This should be, you know, ferritin should be in the levels of maybe 100, you know, the C-reactive protein in the levels of maybe 5. Micrograms, milligrams per ml. And these are, you know, 200, 700. These people were very sick. Upon admission in a matter of hours, a couple of days, the temperature went up. The patient starts having important problems in the saturation of oxygen and in the blood and the hemoglobin content. And finally, the saturation of oxygen becomes below 70-80%. At 60%, you cannot live with that. We tried to resuscitate unsuccessfully, and finally the patient unfortunately died of the disease. And when we did the autopsy, we saw lungs that were quite affected with these hyaline membranes and these gigantic cells that were taken by the virus that didn't allow the wall of the lung to be open enough for the oxygen to go from the air inside of the blood vessels, but also the cells not to function because they were invaded which we've proven by electron micrographs that prove that in a specific cells, the virus was inside and colonizing and taking over as an enemy, dysfunctional cells. Another thing that we learned is that where all of this inflammation came, because we didn't see a lot of lymphocytes, and we realized that the real group of cells that were producing this release of cytokines, of inflammatory markers, were the cells that they are the scavenger cells, you know, what we call the macrophages. And this has a name, it's called the macrophage activated syndrome, which is very much classical as a presentation in some diseases, including the so-called Kawasaki disease, that it's a disease of children, that it's not very well known why it's happening, but the main result is that the macrophages, you know, that get very upset and they start producing high amounts of inflammatory, you know, cytokines and markers that make the body very sick. So as part of this group of autopsies, we said, yes, this is a disease in which the virus penetrates through the respiratory system, goes into the nose, goes down into the lungs, affect the epithelial cells, produces this kind of shortness of breath, and the macrophages produce all of this inflammatory syndrome. And when you put that together in a context of a big deal of respiratory damage, patients may die. And sometimes in these patients, a pneumonia from a bacteria is also overimposed and the case becomes very complex. And that was fitting the picture of a respiratory illness. But then some patients came with fatigue, with night sweats, with diarrhea, with abnormal renal functions, presenting loss of memory, delusion, teachers of English as a language were not able to spell and to write well, people start losing the sense of a smell. What was happening? This was not a respiratory illness anymore. That was a much more widespread disease in the body. And I think that this case represents very well what happened. This is a 60-year-old male that came with this kind of symptomatology. And at admission, again, all of the markers of inflammation were very high. By the way, look at the temperature, 37.1. That's not really fever in my book. So slowly but surely, this patient, instead of just having respiratory illness, starts having a much more profound derangement of the heartbeats, the developments in the context of also the cognition, the sense of a smell, becomes very ill, needs to be transferred into the ICU, produces several developments in renal failure and heart arrest, and finally the patient becomes very ill and cannot sustain life and expires, dies of the disease. And one of the most critical things that we learned was when we explore in this patient the brain, because we realized that the brain was full of microhemorrhages, it was full of microthrombi, it was full of derangements in the blood vessels, which were then confirmed by when we put the slides of the brain under the microscope, and we realized that the blood vessels were completely occluded and occupied by these microthrombi. And we asked the question, can it be that besides the epithelial cells that have these receptors, maybe the endothelial cells also have these receptors for this specific virus and this disease? And the answer was yes. In a moment of inspiration, we got reagents that could identify these receptors in the tissue sections of these organs, and we proved by immunohistochemistry that the blood vessels of the heart, of the brain, of the lung, and some other organs had the receptors and got affected. That allows us to produce the next step in the understanding the disease, that not only the virus infected the mucosa of the nasopharynx and then the lungs, but that the virus, like a cancer cell, learned how to travel against the blood vessels and produce like a metastatic spread. Metastasis is a term that we have used only essentially for cancer, but metastasis really means when a pathogen, which can be a neoplastic transformed cancer cell, or a virus, or a bacteria, goes into the blood vessels, learn how to penetrate and circulate, and then produces a new niche at distance from the site of origin. So in that context, COVID-19, it's a metastatic disease. It's a disease that can travel the blood vessel, can also affect the blood vessel, and by doing that, produces a disease that is generalized, that produces endothelial dysfunction. The macrophage-activated syndrome altogether produce an incredible immune response, and too much of something good is always going to be bad, which is then associated with this cytokine release and this inflammatory burst that these patients suffer. And unfortunately, this goes into another level with damage of the blood vessels and thrombi, coagulopathy exists, and then all of a sudden, all of the organs suffer the lack of oxygen, what we call hypoxia. They became very ill. They produce a multi-organ failure that leads into specific instances to death. So one of the things that we learn with Dr. Valentin Fuster, the chair of cardiology, is that if you give to these patients, you know, blood thinners, you know, anticoagulants, antithrombotics, these patients do much better. So that was an observation in the autopsies that helped produce a better therapeutic intervention for which now we are giving not towards the end, but also in the middle or even sometimes in the beginning of the disease, depending on the comorbidities of these individuals. So that brings us to a new and very important concept of staging the disease. Not only we produce, as we said in the beginning, the diagnosis, but also the staging. So we are proposing a staging of this disease, and this may be one of the first, if not the first, attempt to produce a classification, a map for which we can produce a journey that brings together the kind of symptomatology of the patient, either you are asymptomatic or you don't feel it, or you are moderate or very critically ill, with what is happening into you, the viral invasion, the dissemination, the inflammation, the organ damage, the tests that we want to do, like the diagnosis with PCR or the disease monitoring with antibodies or other markers, together with therapeutic interventions in order to facilitate the physicians, but essentially also to educate the population at large and our leaders in order to understand how to navigate and how to bring this anxiety down. Because if you don't know, you can be very anxious, but if you know, you at least have a route to travel to with a map that is well annotated. So that was what we produced during these difficult times of COVID-19. And this is who we are. We, the pathologists, the laboratorians. You may not know us, but we know you better than anybody. And when the viral enters and it's very high, we guide the infectious disease to give you antivirals. If the inflammation is high, we guide the internist to give you steroids. When we see that your coagulation is in trouble, we guide the cardiovascular teams to give you blood thinners. And when everything fails, we can then accept, you know, one of the most incredible acts of human kindness, which is for a family or a diseased patient before dying to say, I want to donate my body so what has happened to me may not happen to others. And it has been a difficult journey sometimes. We protect ourselves. Nobody in my department became really very ill, but some people became antibody positive and some people had some symptomatology and they were sick because we were putting, you know, our passion and our life on the line to better understand this disease. And if you commit to medicine and if you commit to pathology, you're going to make one day an oath that is going to say that you're going to protect yourself and your families and your communities, but you're going to be willing to produce this next step of act of kindness and courage to say, they need me, I'm going to be there. And sometimes history gives us the opportunity to come all together. And I think that I speak for the entire Department of Pathology in this community, that we work here every day. And I know that there is a lot that needs to be learned still about COVID-19, about cancer, about many diseases, but we are learning a lot. And we are learning a lot because we are at a very special institution. It's called Mount Sinai, that sits in the center of one of the most exciting cities in the world, with ethnic, race, age, variability that is so unique. There is a reason why the United Nations are also in this city. So our network of hospitals and clinics give us access to communities that are very unique in the context of what we do. And it has been in that context that leadership has been very open and giving us the opportunity to have the tools and the resources that were needed in times of difficulties. Up to you. Thank you.